Hi, welcome back. This session, I'd like to start talking about arbitrage. Arbitrage is a word that I think is thrown around far too easily in financial markets because the actual definition of arbitrage is fairly strict. For an investment to be an arbitrage investment, you need to be able to invest no money, take no risk, and walk away with sure profits. It's a money machine. Now, you can already see why pure arbitrage is so difficult to find. While I will talk about the potential for pure arbitrage in this session, most times when you hear people talk about arbitrage in the real world, it's not pure arbitrage, it's what I call near arbitrage, which is, you know, assets that are very similar to each other but are not perfectly identical, where there's some risk, or speculative arbitrage, which is really not arbitrage at all, it's more speculation than arbitrage, where you try to take advantage of mispriced assets and then try to buy the cheaper one and the more expensive one and hope that they converge on the right prices. So let's focus in on just pure arbitrage for this session. Okay? Pure arbitrage, you have to find two assets that are exactly identical. They have to have exactly identical in what sense? They have to provide you with the same cash flows and they have to be trading at different prices. Now, you can already see why pure arbitrage is going to be tough to find. First, it's very difficult to find identical assets out there. You can find things that are similar to each other, but exactly the same. It's tough to do. Second, even if those two identical assets exist, you got to find them priced at different prices in two different markets, at which point you got to stop and ask, why might that be? If they're the exact same asset, so let's assume you are an investor who's found identical assets, they're priced differently in different markets. There's a third piece of the puzzle. Once you buy the cheaper and sell the more expensive of the same asset, you need prices to converge. So the third piece that you need for arbitrage to work is those prices have to converge. So given those three requirements, identical assets, mispricing in different markets, a price convergence state, it's not difficult to see why pure arbitrage is almost always going to be restricted to the derivative markets. Futures and options are the only places where you're likely to see pure arbitrage at play. So what I'd like to focus on in the rest of the session is why there might be pure arbitrage opportunities in futures and options market, why they might even open up, and whether you can actually make money off those opportunities. So let's start with futures arbitrage. In a futures contract, you get the right to buy or sell something at a fixed date in the future at a price that's specified now. So the key to a futures contract is you're agreeing to do something in the future, but you set the price today at which you will do it. Now, the key to understanding arbitrage in futures contracts is to recognize there are two strategies that deliver the same end results if you want something at a point in time in the future. So let's assume that you want 100 ounces of gold 3 months from now. You can buy a futures contract that locks in the price of gold today. So you have no risk, so you buy the contract today. And essentially, at the end of 3 months, you deliver the price, you collect the gold. So that's one strategy. Here's the second one. You can buy the gold today, at today's price. You can store it for the next 3 months and take it out at the end of the 3 months. So at the end of 3 months, the net effect is the same. You have 100 ounces of gold. You had no risk because in the first strategy, you locked in the price in the futures contract. And the second one, you actually borrowed the money and bought the gold right now. So you know exactly what the price was you paid for the gold. And you know what interest rate you have to pay on your debt. So in other words, both strategies deliver the same end result, have no risk, and effectively are substitutes for each other. Because of that, you can argue that that what you need to invest in the two strategies has to be the same, because if they're different, then here's what you're going to do. You're going to go long or buy the first strategy, the cheaper strategy, and sell the more expensive strategy. And because they deliver the same end result, you're not exposed to any risk, you should be able to walk away with the difference. So let's stop talking in abstractions. Let's use a storable commodity future to kind of illustrate how this works. So let's assume that you have a storable commodity. What's a storable commodity? A commodity you can put into storage. You have to pay a storage cost. It could be gold. It could be oil. No. So first strategy, you buy the futures contract. So that's all. It's a simple strategy. Go buy the 3 month or the 5 month or the 6 month futures contract. You take delivery at expiration. So there's nothing you need to do now or over the life of the contract, but on expiration, You take delivery of the commodity and you pay your agreed upon futures price. Let's call it F. Here's your second strategy. You borrow the spot price of the commodity, oil, gold, whatever the commodity is. You buy the commodity today, you store it. There are two costs you're going to face. One is because you borrowed the money to buy the commodity, you have to pay interest on that price. So if the spot price is S and the interest rate is R, you'll have to pay interest for whatever time period you've borrowed the money for, which is the life of the futures contract. So that becomes the first cost, is the interest cost. The second cost is the storage cost. Now, with some commodities, you might actually, the person you store the commodity with might actually get some benefit from the storage. So that's got to be netted out against the cost of the storage. So that's called the convenience yield. So that cost, let's assume, is a function of the spot price. Now, in this case, let's call it K. It's a percentage of the spot price. And it's specified, and let's say that's specified as an annual cost. So if your contract is a two-year contract, six-month contract, it's got to be scaled. So T captures that. So there are two strategies there. You can either buy the futures contract, in which case you'll pay F dollars in at the end of the futures contract when the contract expires. Or you can borrow the money, buy the commodity, in which case the cost of your total cost of your overall strategy will be what you see listed here. It'll be the spot price times 1 plus R raised to the power T, that's the interest cost, plus the storage cost net of convenience. Because the two strategies are equivalent in terms of risk and final result, they should have the same price. So the arbitrage price for the futures contract is basically the price that you see listed on the bottom of the page. You're saying, what do I do with that? Let's say the actual futures contract sells at a price lower than that F star. So F star is your arbitrage price. So the futures contract sells for less. Here's what you're going to do. You're going to buy the futures contract. Then you're going to sell short on strategy two, which means you're going to sell the commodity for the spot price, lend the money out at the riskless rate, and then cover the storage, then essentially collect on the storage cost. Okay. Let me give you an easier version of this. Let's suppose F is greater than F star. The futures price is higher than F star. You're going to go out and you're going to buy strategy two. So you're going to borrow the spot price, buy the commodity, and enter into all these agreements you need to enter into. You're going to sell the futures contract. Okay? At expiration, you're going to collect F because that's greater than S times 1 plus. You're going to take the difference and you're going to keep the profit. So it's actually easier to, because of the nature of this process, it's therefore easier to take advantage of F being greater than F star, the futures contract being overpriced, than if it's underpriced. Because if it's underpriced, you got to sell short on the commodity, which is more messy than buying the commodity. You got to lend the money out at the risk-free rate, more difficult than borrowing at the risk-free rate. Here's the trickiest part. Is you need to be able to collect that saved storage cost, which might or might not be feasible. But if you are able to do that, the futures contract has to sell at the arbitrage price. In the real world, because there are costs, you might not be able to sell short, or the cost of storage might be different, you might not be able to collect it. What that'll create is a band around the futures price, around F star, around which there's no arbitrage. And if the price goes above that band or below the band, you can exploit it to make money. So that's a futures contract on a storable commodity. What if you have a non-storable commodity? Then arbitrage is not possible, so let it go. There's another set of futures contracts that have kind of become a much bigger factor in the last 30 years, which are futures contract on financial assets, on stock indices, on T-bonds, and currencies. So let's talk about how those contracts are going to be specified. To see what the arbitrage relationship is for a stock index future, again, think of two different strategies. Here's the first one. Okay? You can sell short, let's say you're looking at an index like the S&P 500. Okay? You can sell short every stock on the index for the duration of the index futures contracts. Okay? When you sell short, you're going to collect the proceeds from selling short, and you're going to invest those proceeds at the riskless rate. If you sell short, the people that you sold that you borrowed the shares from, that you sold short, need to be compensated for the dividends they'd have received on those stocks while they held the stocks. Okay? So the first strategy is a little messy. You sell short on stocks in the index for the duration of the index futures contracts. You invest the money, and then you keep track of the dividends on those stocks because you got to compensate the owners of these stocks for the dividends. Here's the second strategy. You can sell the index futures contract. Effectively, you've accomplished the same results, which is at the end of the process, you will have to deliver the futures contract. And if you look at the costs of the two strategies, the cost of the second strategy, or what you're going to get in the second strategy, is F star, is the futures contract price. In the first strategy, you're going to be paying out the current spot price. You're going to make the interest on that spot price because that money is going to get lent out. And because you have to pay the dividends out of that interest, you have to net out the dividends. So the R minus Y, so the dividends operate like a convenience yield. While you're holding the stock, you get the dividend, you use it to cover the interest rate you have on your debt. So that becomes essentially the value, the cost of strategy one, that becomes the cost of strategy two. In a world with no frictions, those two have to converge. Again, in the real world, because selling short might be more expensive than buying stocks, there might be constraints. There's going to be a band around that F star. So if the futures contract price, the futures price goes beyond, outside of those bounds, you're going to see arbitrage kick in. So index futures, again, you're trying to accomplish the same thing. You're saying, what are the two ways I can end up with the same result? Given that they have the same risk and the same cash flows, they need to be selling at the same price. Here's the third example. Let's say you have a futures contract on a T-bond. Okay? The value that futures contract again can be specified as a value of the current spot price of the T-bond. That's what the S is. Minus the present value of the coupons during the life. Because if you sell short those bonds, you got to cover the coupons, so you're taking out the coupons, and you lend that money out at the riskless rate, so that's the 1 plus R. Again, the futures contract has to be equal to the price. Again, the coupons take on the same role as the dividend yields did for the stock index futures, but the logic remains the same. You have two ways of doing the same thing, a T-bond future, or going out and selling short on the bond, investing the money at the riskless rate, and covering the coupon payments. The two have to be equivalent, and that's what specifies the arbitrage relationship. Final example, what about currency futures? You've got US dollar versus the yen, US dollar versus the euro. Again, the relationship here is a very simple one, and it depends on two numbers. What the interest rate in the domestic currency is, whatever the domestic currency is, and whatever the interest rate is in your foreign currency. So as an example, let's suppose you are trying to get a futures contract for euros and dollars. You need a risk-free rate in euros and a risk-free rate in dollars. If your euro risk-free rate and dollar risk-free rate are the same, your futures price will be equal to your spot price. If your futures, if the interest rates diverge, then the futures price is going to diverge from the spot price. And again, this relationship is obtained by thinking about the arbitrage relationship. What do we know? Thinking about the two ways you can deliver the same result. In this case, by either selling a currency future, just buying that selling short on the currency and covering it in the future. So essentially, you're accomplishing the same thing, and you're looking at what the cost will be to you. One thing that makes currency futures a little easier than T-bonds or stock indices, you don't have dividends or coupons, the equivalent, to worry about. This is called interest rate parity in the exchange rate in the foreign currency market. And essentially, the relationship has to hold if you have two currencies, because if it did not hold, you'd have people coming in and making money off that, of the divergence from the arbitrage relationship. Now, of course, for this futures contract price to hold, the currencies need to be floating rate currencies that are tradable. So the minute you start to put restrictions on trading and other constraints in the process, then arbitrage will start to break down. So when you think about the feasibility of futures arbitrage, I mean, the Garbade and Silver a long time ago looked at futures markets and concluded that there was very little evidence of lots of arbitrage opportunities, and that's not surprising. It's too easy to uncover, too easy to exploit. You shouldn't expect them to show around. If you decide to go down this road of trying to make arbitrage profits in the futures market, you have to find what your niche is. What's your competitive advantage? And it's tough to see what it could be. You could argue that you have a transactions cost competitive advantage over whom? Over other big institutional investors? An information advantage? But again, you're talking about entire indices or T-bonds. It's difficult to see what that information advantage is. But here's an interesting finding from at least the financial futures markets. When futures contracts are first introduced on an asset, it looks like there are arbitrage opportunities. For some reason, markets take a while to learn the process. And while they're learning, if you're a little quicker than everybody else, you might be able to take advantage of it. So in the first few years of the index futures market, you did see people able to exploit arbitrage and make money. Now, if you look at that same market, you don't see those opportunities. So maybe there is an opening there for arbitrage if you can find a futures contract on an asset that has never been, that did not exist before. Let's talk about options arbitrage. Options are derivative assets. They are rights rather than obligations. With a call option, you get the right to buy something at a fixed price. With a put option, you get the right to sell something at a fixed price. Essentially, you're doing this on an underlying asset that's usually traded. So essentially, one key feature that separates options from futures is while futures contracts have potentially unlimited profits and losses, an options contract, if you bought the contract, you cannot lose more than what you originally paid for the option. There's usually an underlying asset that trades, and in fact, all option pricing models are built on a simple premise, that you can replicate the option. In other words, you can create something that looks exactly like the option in terms of cash flows by combining the underlying asset and either borrowing, if you have a call option, or if you have a put option, selling short on that underlying asset and lending that money. That's the key to understanding option arbitrage. But let's think about the different variations of arbitrage that might show up in options market. The simplest arbitrage you can have is what's called exercise arbitrage. What's exercise arbitrage? Let's say you have a stock trading at 50. You have a call option with a strike price of 40. If you exercise that option today, you make $10, right? If you could buy that option, if for some reason it were trading at 7 or 7.50 or $8, you have a money machine. Buy the option at 8, exercise at 10, make the difference. That's pure exercise arbitrage. You can almost guarantee that if you're looking at any kind of liquid market, you're not going to find that. You can put in tighter bounds on arbitrage. In other words, you can say the value of a call, for instance, rather than being greater than the value of the exercise value, has to be greater than the value of the underlying asset and the present value of the strike price. Present value of the strike price, because in a call option, you get the right to buy the asset at a fixed price, but not until the option expires. So you can start looking for the outer bounds. Maybe you might be able to find options that are trading at too low a price relative to those bounds. But even that, it's very doubtful in a liquid market. You're going to find easy arbitrage, which is what exercise arbitrage is. Then you can also have pricing arbitrage. What's pricing arbitrage? Remember, I said you could create something that looks exactly like the option by combining the underlying asset and borrowing and lending. That's called the replicating portfolio. If you've created a perfect replicating portfolio and you have a call option or a put option and they're priced at different values, you're going to buy the cheaper version, whether it's the option or the replicating portfolio, sell short the more expensive version, and keep the difference, because the cash flows in the two positions will exactly offset each other. And there's no risk. And therefore, you'll walk away with the difference. Okay? That's pricing arbitrage. Does that exist? The problem, of course, is that replicating portfolio is a minute-by-minute process. And creating a self-financing replicating portfolio that rolls over through time is tough to do. So if there's pricing arbitrage, people have kept it a closely guarded secret. And it's very difficult to see how you can put this into play in a real market where the pricing process itself is shifting over time. The third type of arbitrage you can get with options is arbitrage across options. So if you have multiple options in the same underlying asset, there are some parity relationships that have to hold that if they're violated, you might be able to take advantage of. One's called put-call parity. If you have a put option and a call option on the same stock with the same expiration date, you can actually create a riskless position by selling the call, buying the put, and buying the underlying asset at the same time. And here's how it's going to work. When you sell the call, here's how much you have to put out. You have to put out the price of the call right now. You have to buy the put, you have to buy the stock. This gives you the payoffs from that combined position at expiration for both scenarios where S is greater than K, S is less than K. If S is greater than K, because you sold the call, you basically have to come up with the difference between the stock price and the strike price, minus of that number. In other words, you got to pay the person who bought the call from you the difference between the stock price and the strike price. That's a negative cash flow. The put is going to be worthless because S is greater than K. Because you bought the stock is now worth S star. If you combine the three, your cash flow, if the stock price is greater than the strike price, is going to be the exercise price. You're saying, what happens if the stock price is less than the strike price? The call is now worthless, so the cash flow is zero. On the put, you're going to make the difference between K and S star, so that's going to be the cash flow from the put. You're going to have the stock at S star. You combine the two. There's your cash flow. So if the stock is less than K, you get K. If stock is greater than K, you make K. If S is equal to K, you make K. No matter what happens at expiration, you're going to make the strike price. So you know what? That's what put call parity specifies. It says, look, if you can combine these two positions and make anything other than K, you're essentially walking away with a pure profit. So that's put call parity. Slightly messier scenarios, you start looking at differences in prices, in option prices, with when the options have different strike prices in the same maturity or even different maturities. Again, there are relationships that bind these together, and you might be able to create combinations of a call with a strike price of 40 and a call with a strike price of 50 on the same stock with the same expiration. And if they're not priced right, you might be able to lock in your profit. Tough to do, but if you can find it, you can lock in the profit. Difference in maturities is much messier. So if you have a $40 strike price call with an expiration in 3 months and a $40 strike price call with an expiration in 6 months, again, there has to be some kind of parity relationship between the two. And to the degree that there isn't, you might be able to take advantage of the difference. The key word here is might. Option pricing arbitrage looks easy on paper. It's much more difficult to find in practice. Finally, fixed income arbitrage. Fixed income securities lend themselves much more easily to arbitrage than equities or stocks because they have a finite maturity. What I mean by that is you have a set of cash flows, you know when the cash flows end. If you find a mispriced bond, you then you know that there's going to be a date of reckoning, the maturity date for the bond where the mispricing has to disappear. So if you have a 10-year bond, it's a collection of 10 sets of cash flows and a face value at the end of the 10th year. You could replicate that 10-year bond by buying a 1-year bond, a 2-year zero coupon bond, a 3-year. In other words, you could replicate the cash flows in a 10-year T-bond with coupons by buying zero coupon treasuries with expirations matching up to those coupon dates. You're saying, so what? Because I can replicate, those two positions have to cost the same, and if they don't, I might be able to essentially take advantage of that difference, lock in my profit today, and not have any cash flows or risk in the future, which actually is the definition of arbitrage. So that's with T-bonds, where you don't have default risk. If you have default risk, things get messier because unless you can find two corporate bonds with exactly the same default risk, and that might be because you have two corporate bonds in the same company. Unless you can find the same default risk, then you got to figure out ways to control for default risk. Often people cheat and find two bonds with the same corporate bond rating, but that's not the same because we know that ratings agencies are not perfect. But again, you're looking for two assets which have exactly the same cash flows and exactly the same risk, but are selling at different prices. Does fixed income arbitrage pay? There is some evidence that if you look at the Treasury Strips program, which is a program introduced by the U.S. Treasury, allowing people to strip the cash flows in a T-bond, that when it first was initiated, people were actually able to make money by creating these little arbitrage opportunities using the stripped cash flows. Another study looking at the Spanish bond market also looked at bonds between 94 and 98 when new innovations had come into these markets and concluded there were arbitrage opportunities. The common theme here, though, is that most of these opportunities showed up in the first 2 or 3 years that these markets were introduced, when there were new markets, mortgage-backed securities, inflation index treasury strips. When they were first introduced, there was an opportunity for arbitrage, but the longer these securities lasted, the less chances there seemed to be for arbitrage. So as with futures, the best chances for arbitrage are in new markets with new securities. Because as these markets age, it seems as if people understand how to price them, and the arbitrage opportunities disappear as that happens. That's pretty much what, you know, the process of arbitrage. If you decide to try your hand at pure arbitrage, my cautionary note is the nature of it, pure arbitrage, that you can find two assets with different prices, identical assets with different prices, where you're guaranteed price convergence. That's a pretty tough order to meet all those requirements. So pure arbitrage is more likely to be accidental. And in fact, I think most examples of pure arbitrage are opportunistic. You happen to be at the right place at the right time when there's a pricing difference. If that is in fact the case, lock in that difference, put in as much money as you can, make money off that arbitrage. But you can't build an investment strategy around expecting that kind of mispricing to show up on regular intervals. And also because you're talking about very small price differences, you're not talking about 10% differences, you're talking about a tenth of a percent. There are a couple of other conditions that you need to have to make this work for you. One is you need to have access to a lot of debt at very favorable rates, as close to the risk-free rate as you can get. And the second is you need economies of scale. So if you have only $1 million to invest, don't even think about pure arbitrage. If you have $1 billion, maybe there's a chance. And there is some point, even in this process, where you can become too big to do pure arbitrage. So it's got to be big enough that you can get the economies of scale, but not so big that you drive out the arbitrage by just announcing that you're going to enter the market. That's the nature of pure arbitrage. And as you can see, it's rare, but if you can find it, it's extraordinarily profitable. In the next couple of sessions, we'll look at the other types of arbitrage, which are not quite pure, and perhaps there are ways you can get close to pure arbitrage, but not quite there, and still make a lot of money. Thank you very much for listening.